right?
Yes.
For church musicians. So we welcome them back.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading today comes from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 and 42. Let us again listen for God's word to us. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village, where a woman named Martha welcomed Jesus into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, this is one of those landmine passages for preachers and biblical interpreters. I felt like this all week. Now, we could take it as artists in paintings have throughout the centuries as sisters pitted against one another. It adds to the trope of women against women. New Testament scholar Harold Lewis says that by pitting the sisters against each other, women for centuries have had to justify their discipleship, their lives of faith, as either following Mary or Martha, as if these two women in Jesus' life are the only way women can imagine what it looks like to be a disciple of Jesus in the present day. I.e., women must be quiet and passive, silent at the feet of Jesus like Mary, or busy in the kitchen like Martha. Those are the only two choices. Now, apart from gender, one could easily slip into saying that sitting around studying the Bible and contemplative worship are more valuable than action and service. The story of the Good Samaritan that we read last week and that comes right before this story seems to say the opposite, though. Go and do likewise, Jesus tells the lawyer, who would have spent much of his day sitting around and studying the Torah. And then with those thoughts, we could think that the story must be about balance then. Jesus wants us to balance service and worship, action and contemplation. But why does he admonish Martha then and praise Mary for making the better, or some translations leave it as the good choice? Now, I experienced this landmine that preachers face when preaching from this passage just last month when I was at another church for an installation service. I wasn't preaching, thank goodness, but was in the pews. And it was a late afternoon service and one of those services that was wonderful that you knew it was going to go long. There was a silver lining, though. This church is known for serving amazing food. And we knew that dinner was happening right after the service. I even smelled it as I walked in that afternoon. My belly was running. The humility and care of the guest preacher in preaching this passage was wonderful, but overall, the message did seem to be about being more like Mary. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, contemplation, worship, study, instead of being an action-oriented Martha. A pastor friend sitting next to me leaned over and whispered in my ear, "I hope all the people in the kitchen can't hear him preaching. I really want dinner afterwards." And as he preached and instructed this newly installed pastor, I thought about my old sense of being as a pastor and the church that I serve. And the conviction came really quickly. I'm a Martha pastor serving a Martha church. Doing comes and has always come way easier for me. I'm not a contemplative, I love study, but I also want to know how I'm going to apply what I'm learning. I get frustrated when there's not enough movement and action. And luckily, I pastor a church that keeps me on my toes and is full of people who love putting their faith into action, as the back of our yellow shirts say. Now, not that you all don't take time to sit at the feet of Jesus, to listen, to find meaning in worship. You do. But this church community would not be possible without all the Marthas, so many, who keep this place running. I'm not going to even start listing all the things that you do, because it will make me exhausted. You see the work of the church, your service as part of your calling. And it's some of the Marthiest among you who are among the most spiritual people that I have met. In the midst of a day of doing, you offer deep insights into the character of God and the life of faith that might be found in a monastery. And gosh darn it, Jesus, why is it that Mary has chosen the better part? Or maybe, just maybe, it's us. Especially us preachers who are missing something here. We miss the point. Which I guess Martha does, too. We miss the point. Caught up in action and contemplation, preaching and serving, we miss the point of why Jesus came to our earthly home. The earth, the homes of our souls in the first place. Now I know it's been all the way since January that we read this passage in Luke. Can you remember what the point of Jesus' coming amongst us was in Luke's gospel? His first act of public ministry, Jesus tells us, he's coming to announce the kingdom of God, a kingdom of freedom. He says in the synagogue, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," quotes from Isaiah, "because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." That's the Jubilee year, a year of freedom. Jesus announces a kingdom of freedom. Freedom to not be defined by our bank accounts. Freedom from whatever holds us captive. Freedom to see who we truly are and who Jesus truly is. Freedom to not be burdened by all that has been placed upon us by others and all that we've placed upon ourselves. And freedom to claim our identity as God's beloved. Freedom to let others claim that identity and soak it in as well. Jesus came so that Mary, a woman, could claim her identity as his disciple, as one of God's beloved. Jesus came so that Mary, like all the men that follow Jesus around, might sit at his feet too, in a posture of discipleship. Jesus came so that Mary might be free from conforming to the expectations of others, including her sister, of what her role in the kingdom of God would look like. Jesus came too to set Martha free, free from enslaving others to her expectations, free from the anger and rage that had built up inside as she did so. Free to not worry about all that must be done. Free to focus on the kingdom at hand. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus announces this kind of freedom in this way. He says, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear, but strive first for the kingdom of God and God's righteousness. And all these things will be given to you as well." Jesus sets us free to be first and foremost citizens of God's kingdom. Our identity is found there, not in anything else. That, I think, might be the one thing Jesus praises Mary for, as opposed to the many things that Martha is distracted by. Do we find our identity in Jesus, or are we enslaved to the many things that offer us a false identity? Jesus, I think, is offering Martha freedom from the lies she tells herself about who she is and the way she is defining others, at least in this moment. I think we all have moments that we need to be reminded of that freedom. Catholic priest, contemplative, and doer Henry Nouwen said that there are 5 lies we tell ourselves about who we are. 5 lies of identity, he calls them. Number 1, I am what I have. I am my home, my education, the car I drive, my children, my health status. Number two, I am what I do. Maybe it's a job or title or role. Maybe it's even something as good as all the ways I serve my community or all the money I give away. And if we define ourselves by what we do, we fail to receive the freedom Jesus offers. Number three, I am what others, people, say or think of me. Ouch. When those voices running in our heads get echoed in positive or negative ways with the voices around us, we can get trapped. Maybe it was the trap Martha was in. Maybe she was known in her community as being the best at hospitality. Maybe her reputation was on the line. She transfers all of that internal stress onto Mary, defining Mary by what Mary is doing or not doing, as the case may be. Maybe Martha was seeking Jesus' approval for what she was doing. Wasn't she doing a great job, Jesus? She was certainly seeking his approval. Number four, I am nothing more than my worst moment. As much as Jesus' words were offering Martha freedom, they had to have cut. Each of the disciples seemed to take their turn, falling flat on their face in front of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And the good news is that Martha's identity wasn't defined by this moment. And our identity isn't defined by our worst moments either. Number five, I am nothing less than my best moment. And as much as Mary shines in this story, her identity is greater than this moment. I'm certain she struggled in her discipleship as much as we do. Maybe the next day Martha got what the kingdom was all about more than she did. Mary was loved in the ups and the downs because of her identity as a child of God. Looking at the list, I wonder, what lie do we need to be set free from? Can we let go of all the many things that try to define us? Can we let go of the many things we use to define others? Can we allow Jesus to set us free for that one thing? Can we be set free to be beloved children of God? May God bless us in our trying and in our failing. May Jesus keep coming to our hearts' homes day after day, setting us free.